الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا، صدق الله العظيم. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: إذا وجد أحدكم في بطنه شيئا فأشكل عليه أخرج منه شيء أم لا، فلا يخرجن من المسجد حتى يسمع صوتا أو يجد ريحا، أخرجه مسلم. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين. جلوشي بالله. Respected brothers, respected elders, mothers and sisters listening at home. For the past 2 weeks, we have been covering some very, very important issues on the subject of adab-e-istinja, etiquette of istinja. Not to forget that purity, cleanliness, paaki, safai is an institute of iman, directly connected with iman. And nazafatu min al-iman, cleanliness is part of iman. And anything that is part of iman, naturally it becomes a target for the shaitan. It's like a bull's eye for the shaitan. That is why until the right degree of purity hasn't been achieved, one cannot even start in the second pillar of Islam, which is salat, after iman, after la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. And rahmatul lil alameen sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given us every detail. In reality, every detail has been covered. If you look at the Quran, if you look at the ahadith, every inch, every millimeter of detail has been given to us. How the shaitan functions, how the shaitan operates. So many times we see, I have seen anyway, and I'm sure you have, that when someone is in the wudu khana, Allahu Akbar, sometimes even to do wudu, simple wudu, in which you only have 4 funds, and wudu becomes an impossible task for that individual. You see that individual suffering, Allahu Akbar, and you really feel sorry for him. By the time he has finished wudu, his entire clothes are drenched in water. You see water here, you see water there, you see water here, splashed everywhere. Allahu Akbar. And he is there just on his one arm. And just to wash the right hand, it would take him about 6-7 minutes, making sure, washing his hands. Going to the extremes to make sure that every part, every inch is wet, making sure nothing is dry. And sometimes you're there looking at that individual, you really don't know how to approach him. You feel scared in a way that you might just offend him. And you've got to approach him with hikmah. And he is directly being toyed by, played by the shaitan. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given us beautiful examples. That is the reason wudu is codified. It has got boundaries. That is why if you want to wash your hands, if you want to make wudu, to wash the hand once is farz. To wash each body part once is farz. But to wash it 3 times, it is sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Everything has a format, my brothers. But you see, this individual there, he's suffering. exceeding even the boundaries of sunnah, taking him so long to do wudu, that if you were to collect the water that he has wasted, it would perhaps suffice three people in his ghusl, three people to do ghusl. And especially in the masjid, it's free of charge. So it's free of charge. And people have this habit. Come and do wudu. Yesterday someone wrote on the board, please can we have tissue paper in the toilet? SubhanAllah, this is Muslims for you, my respected brothers. Arrogance. Can we have tissue paper in the toilet? Can't you bring tissue paper? Can't you put tissue paper in your pocket? Mosque provides everything. Can't you bring tissue paper, my brothers? Allahu Akbar. And the reason we don't put tissue paper there is because the toilets get blocked, because we have children madrasa, we have students coming in using the toilets, and that area becomes, subhanAllah, it's like a dustbin when a child has been in that toilet. It's hard even to clean up. But there it was on the board, can we have tissue paper? Can we have tissue paper? SubhanAllah. You should bring it from your own house, spend money and buy tissue paper. Don't expect the mosque to provide everything for you. Alhamdulillah, the mosque people are doing as much as they can. The reason for that, three times, is that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew exactly that the shaitan is there. The shaitan will be there, and a particular group of non-Muslim jinns, shayateen, they are known as the Walhan jinnas. What are they known as? Walhan jinnas. And their assignment is to only disturb that individual when he is doing wudu and ghusl. That is all. They won't interfere in salat. That is the mission for someone else. The interference of the Walhan jinnas is only when that individual is at home, she or he is at home, and he is doing, or she is doing wudu. And when he completes wudu, shaitan is still there. He's still got shuk. And this is the power of this Walhan jinnah, that he takes away confidence from you and replaces confidence with what we call in Urdu, shakki mizaj. What do we call that? Shakki mizaj. Temperament of uncertainty. Temperament of uncertainty. He is never confident. This is what the Walhan jinnah does. Takes away confidence from you. Huzur alayhi salam, I said clearly, wash your hands three times. Is that difficult? Not difficult. SubhanAllah, even once is safi, but sunnah is three times. That's it, three times you wash it, your wudu is done. But even when the wudu is completed, and when he walks out from the wudu khana, he is still not satisfied. And the vibes are there in the heart. Did I make masa properly? Was my elbow dry or wet? Was the heel of my feet washed properly? Did I do masa properly? Did the water reach the fingers properly? These are the vibes. When he climbs up to the masjid, these are the shukuk that are in the heart. He's not satisfied. This is Walhan, full action. Islam is so beautiful. It answers all your questions. That is why we wash three times. Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam has given us a system so the shaitan cannot overpower us. We wash it three times and that's it, finished. We wash it three times. And even when one does ghusl, when he is doing ghusl and the ghusl has been completed, especially when it's farz ghusl, and women also are included in this wasfasa. They've done their ghusl and then they wonder, oh, was my hair, did I wash my hair properly? Did water reach the belly button properly? These are the wives that come in. Did I wash my feet properly? And he or she has put on her clothes and now the shaitan is saying, are you sure you did ghusl properly? Giving
her taklif, giving this individual taklif, this is from the shaitan. A shaitan called, what is this group of shaitan who work with that individual in? Walhan, remember this names by the book. Walhan shayateen, Walhan shayateen. Jinnat, Walhan. You can't see them, but they are there. Different type of shayateen, different jinnat. You have another group of shayateen, they are known as Al-Gharoor shaitan. What are they? Al-Gharoor. Al-Gharoor literally means dhoka, to deceive someone, to delude someone, to show him a picture which in reality is not that picture. To give him dhoka. That is why another name for dunya is also gharoor. Another name for dunya is al-gharoor. Like another name for the face is wajhun, and also as-sahifa in Arabic. As-sahifa, a book. A book. وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, let not the shaitan deceive you. وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورِ And the tafsir of al-gharoor here is either shaitan or either dunya. Let not the dunya deceive you, or let not the shaitan deceive you, because gharoor is the name of a shaitan and gharoor is another name of this dunya. And you combine the two, it's usually the shaitan deceives one through the love of this dunya. So it's all the same. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given us beautiful examples. Beautiful examples. So when you do wuzu, my respected brothers, let not the shaitan take authority over you. He is so powerful. So powerful. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, ثُمَّ لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ وَعَنْ أَيْمَانِهِمْ وَعَنْ شَمَائِلِهِمْ I will come to him, my onslaught, my attack on this individual will be from the right, left, front, back, everywhere, four corners. I am going to take him, he is my target. We are missiled by the shaitan. Every corner, even when we are sleeping, even when we wake up, some of the things I really don't want to mention because we have so many young boys sitting here. Missiles by the shaitan. 24 hours a day. And then once the wuzu has been completed, we come to the second stage. And normally wuzu is done because one wants to pray salat, make salat, or he wants to touch the Quran. And then the second group of shayateen come. The second group of shayateen. The mission of Walhan has been completed. The second group come. All shayateen, powerful shayateen. All have their own special assignment from the superior one. Superior one. They are very, very powerful. And the second group of shayateen are known as the Khanzab shayateen, not Hanzab. Not? Not Hanzab. I'm not sure where they got this word Hanzab from. Maybe from Khanzab, eh? How do we know? But Khanzab shayateen, what are they known as? Khanzab. You know, we have this people are Gujarati, this people are Punjabi, this people are whatever, you know, from other parts of the world. So even in shayateen, they have categories. They are recognized. So when one comes, when one shaitan meets another shaitan, he knows through his identity, oh, you are from the Khanzab. Khanzab brotherhood. Khanzab brotherhood. The other one says, oh yeah, we are from the Walhan society of things. We are from the Walhan society of non-Muslim jinns. Another one will say, no, we are from the Al-Gharoor society of non-Muslim jinn. They all have their categories, class A, like having drugs. Class A, class B, class C. All sorts of names you have. Class A drugs, different punishment. Caught with that, different punishment. Class B, different punishment. Class C, different punishment. Similarly, shayateen, all have their own identities. One is a Hafiz, one is a Tari, one is a Ali, one is a Mufti, one, and subhanAllah, It continues. Professional people, shayateen are professional. So the hands of shayateen, they are also powerful shayateen. Powerful shayateen. And shaitan is not only one. Shaitan is not only one. People have this picture that shaitan is only one. No, no. Malakul Maut is not only one. Yes, the real Malakul Maut is just one. But under that Malakul Maut, so many farishtas, malaika are operating. So many malaika. But he is famously known as Malakul Maut. He is the chef. He is the main farishta who handles, who coordinates death that takes place everywhere in the world. He is the main farishta, malaika. Allah has given him that responsibility. And Imam Muslim rahmatullah alayhi has endorsed one hadith in which Hazrat Usman bin Abil Aas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says to Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that a beautiful question asked by that companion, and that is his own individual experience. So you can imagine how powerful the shaitan is, that the shaitan here is also manipulating with the companion, with the sahabi. So what are we, my respected brothers? We are nothing really. And he came to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, إن الشيطان قد حال بيني وبين صلاتي وبين قراءتي. That every time I say Allahu Akbar, I can see, I can feel the shaitan comes to me. I can feel the shaitan comes in between me, my salat and my qira'at. My qira'at. So many times we pray salat and it's four rakat farz, but we are somewhere else. And in the second rakat, we are just meant to read at-tahiyyat, tashahud. And after tahiyyat, we are supposed to stand up straight away. It is wajib to stand up straight away, without delay. Namaz is a cycle. The minute you say Allahu Akbar, time is not to be wasted. Any time waken to the limit of three subhanallah, sajday sahwa becomes wajib. Sajday sahwa becomes wajib. It's not something that, oh, walaqallin, ameen, and you get some people who like to scream ameen out. And I hope the intentions are good. But because according to fiqh-i hanfiyya, ameen is dua, ameen is dua, and dua sirri is better, makhfi, not audible, quietly, ameen, ameen. And after ameen, if you take time to read, oh, I just start, not feeling well, 5 minutes, and then after that he starts. Subhanallah. That's not salat. It's a continuation. The limit you are given is only three subhanallahs. How many subhanallahs? Three subhanallahs. After that, sajday sahwa is there. Sajday sahwa is there. Very, very important. So now we pray salat. I was on the fourth rakat farz, and after at-tahiyyat, you're not meant to read durood Ibrahim or durood. And because the mind is somewhere else, because this khanzab, shaitan, is attacking you, which is in Muslim Sharif, and you don't even realize that. So after reading Guru Sharif, you stand up, oh, it's my third rakat. You have to do sajdah. Sometimes even when we are in ruku and sujood, we are just fulfilling the formality, just in ruku. But he's dozing off, he's not reading the tasbihat. He's just in ruku, just in ruku, just in sujood. Even individually, when you read walaqallin, when you finish Surah Fatiha, you have to say ameen. A lot of people don't read ameen. A lot of people. Ameen. And our favorite surahs are Qul huwallahu ahad, Allahu samad. Favorite surah. Mind you, I read that today in Maghrib also. And inna atayna kal kawthar. إِنَّا عَطَيْنَا And we don't want to go beyond 10 surahs. You know, we don't even have that zeal to learn. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ذَبْحًا فَالْمُورِ Leave that to Maulana Dawood Sahib. Let him pray the long, long surahs. إِذَا السَّمَاءُ انْفَطَرَتْ لَمْ يَكُنِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ مُنْفَكِينَ حَتَّى that and subhanAllah, but if you know the translation, Allahu Akbar Kabira. The difference, my brothers, when you read the Quran and you know the words, the recitation, it's different. So the shaitan is attacking me. He says, Ya Rasulullah, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ قَدْ حَالَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ صَلَاتِي وَبَيْنَ قِرَاتِي I figure I'm making mistakes even in my qiraat. What does Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? Huzur alayhi salatu wa sallam said to him, ذَلِكَ شَيْطَانٌ That is shaytan. That is shaytan. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives you the full explanation. He says, ذَلِكَ شَيْطَانٌ يُقَالُ لَهُ خَنْزَبْ He is that shaytan who is titled by the name of Khanzab. He is titled by the name of Khanzab. Every time you say Allahu Akbar, the shaitan will come. And you will notice that if you are sitting in the masjid and sitting comfortably, you won't imagine anything. Nothing will happen to you. Thoughts won't come to you. Your heart will be totally vacant. Just sitting in this posture in the mosque. But the minute you say, Allahu Akbar, he interferes. The minute you say, Allahu Akbar, everything that real operates. You have to do that, you have to do this, make sure, you know, you've got so much work to do at home, so pray your salat quickly and go do that, you can finish that off. Everything is there typed, Allahu Akbar. And that is the second shift. After, once the Walhan Shayateen have done their work, the second lot come in. And they are known as the Khans of Shayateen. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also gives us the medicine, the cure. And it is that when you finish Salat, read Ta'awuz, read A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem and spit on your left hand side 3 times. Are you going to do it here in Masjid Omar? Spit on the one next door to you. Talk there. Spit on it. So what are you doing? And I said, spit on the person on the left hand side. You're not going to spit, are you? They're not meant to spit. Don't take spitting literally. Don't take spitting literally. That is why according to Ahnaf Imam Abu Hanifa Rahmatullah Alayhi, that miswak is part of wuzu. Miswak is part of wuzu and not salat. Not salat, because if you do miswak just before salat, you have everything, the particles of that miswak with itself, it's in your mouth. And sometimes naturally one will do one, sometimes naturally. So it's like spitting in the masjid. It's like spitting in the masjid. So that is why miswak is part of wudu. Siqah is ajeeb or gharib. Without siqah, you can't stand, my brothers. Siqah is the greatest thing, the greatest ni'mah. وَمَا كَانَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لِيَنْفِرُوا كَافَّةً Not everyone should go for jihad. فَلَوْلَا نَفَرَ مِنْ كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ مِنْهُمْ طَائِفَةٌ لِيَتَفَقَّهُ فِي الدِّينِ So when the companions go from Medina Munawwara for jihad, there is another body, a group of people, scholars, who sit in Medina Munawwara for fiqh. What do they sit for? Fiqh. To understand masail. مَنْ فَمَتَ نَجَاءَ Unfortunately, we have this sickness today. You read Bukhari Sharif translation or in English, MashaAllah, I can speak English. I know the translation. SubhanAllah. And he becomes Imam Bukhari. He becomes Subhanallah al-Azim, la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Great scholars, my brothers, great scholars. He's not even a hafiz of the Quran. Not even a hafiz of the Quran. One of the main things is to make sure you're hafiz of the Quran. And then once you're hafiz of the Quran, you have to be hafiz of hadith. You have to be hafiz of hadith. Who is Hafiz of Hadith today? How many people are Hafiz of Hadith today? Nobody. Nobody is Hafiz of Hadith. Subhanallah. So Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given us beautiful, clear examples how to overpower, how to overcome the lure of the shaitan. And the hadith which I read to you in the khutbah, this is a beautiful hadith. I want all the brothers to pay attention. Beautiful hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like how a soluble tablet would dissolve in water. If you practice or apply this hadith in its correct way, all the malicious methods of the shayateen are dissolved. Straight away. Straight away. Beautiful power Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given us. An Abi Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala an, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إذا وجد أحدكم في بدنه شيئا فأشكل عليه أخرج منه شيء أم لا فلا يخرجن من المسجد حتى يسمع صوتا أو يجد ريحا. The Sahabi who has narrated this hadith is Hazrat Abu Huraira رضي الله تعالى عنه, and he says that Nabi Kareem صلى الله عليه وسلم has mentioned إذا وجد أحدكم في بطنه شيء, when one notices something in the stomach, فأشكل عليه, for an example, the stomach is making funny noises, grumbling away, funny noises. You had a full meal. فأشكل عليه, and it becomes مشكل for him. He can't diagnose the situation properly. أخرج منه شيء أم لا? And there is this element of suspicion inside this individual that there is a possibility, because the stomach is moving, the diaphragm of the stomach is moving, there is a possibility that wind has been discharged from the anal passage. Wuzu has been broken. But he is not sure. He is not confident. He is not confident. And let me just read the second hadith, which is even more explicit, by Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala. And he says, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَأْتِي أَحَدَكُمْ. What a beautiful hadith. Subhanallah. Gives great satisfaction. Gives pleasure to each individual Muslim, male or female. That every time the mu'min, the Muslim, when he says Allahu Akbar, the shaitan comes. The hands of shaitan comes. إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَأْتِي. The shaitan comes to you. فَيَنْفُخَ فِي مَقْعَدَتِهِ, and he blows in you. He blows in you from the anal passage. What does he do? Blows in you from the anal passage. And Allah has given him this power. This dunya is an examination. We are in the examination hall. Tribulation is there for me and you. The shaitan is there. This dunya is there. It's imtihan. This dunya is darul imtihan. Access has been given to shaitan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing us. So the shaitan is there blowing from the anal passage. And so when he is blowing the back passage, the anal part, you feel that there is a possibility that wuzu has been broken. Naturally. And you will notice that every time you come and you say Allahu Akbar, you see that, oh, have I got wuzu or not? Have I got wuzu or not? And especially this day and age, because we eat, the food we eat is full of gas, and let's not forget Coca-Cola, let's not forget fizzy drinks. It's full of gas. And that works out to be an advantage for the shaitan. And when that individual stands, the shaitan is there blowing in the stomach. So the stomach moves, and he feels that فَيُخَيِّلُ إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ أَحْدَثُ, and the khiyal, the picture that is given to him is that my wuzu has been broken. Wind has been discharged from the anal passage. And in reality, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that his wuzu is intact. His wudu is intact. So what do we do in that position? What do we do? A lot of people have that problem. So many people have this problem. Hard to complete his wudu without the disturbance from the shaitan. Ghusl becomes a difficulty. And even when he completes his ghusl or wudu, and then when he says Allahu Akbar, there is shaitan there to overpower. And when he says Allahu Akbar, it's so difficult for him just to pray four rakat. He feels that my wudu has been broken. Hawa came out. Again, a beautiful dawa, a beautiful remedy from Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says that فَلَا يَخْرُجَنَّ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ. Do not renew your wudu. Don't break your salat. Don't nullify your salat. حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ صَوْتًا. Until you hear with your two ears the wind being discharged from the anal passage. We are not meant to laugh, my brother. It's there, it's natural. It's there, it's natural. Until you can hear, these are words of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Can you imagine rahmatul lil alameen giving us absolutely full maximum detail of what to do and what not to do, just to overcome, just to overpower the shaitan. Until you hear, don't break your salah. Or what? Aw yajid rihan. Or until bad order can be sent. So when your wudu breaks, hawa, you can feel sometimes that bad smell is. So if these two conditions are found, that is the time your wudu has been broken. But make sure, my brothers, don't take this hadith, don't play this hadith the wrong way. Don't play this hadith the wrong way. You have to be very, very careful. So next time when you say Allahu Akbar, and you know for sure that your wudu has been broken, you say, oh, I can't smell anything and I didn't hear anything. Mawlana Muhammad Sahib gave us a beautiful hadith explanation. Don't put any blame on me, my brother. Don't fool yourself. This is just a hadith day for those people who are shakki mizaj. Every time they are suffering, they have this temperament of uncertainty. They have shak in everything. And when you have this binari of shak, my brother, Allahu Akbar, it can really destroy you. That's why always be confident. Always be confident. We don't need any proof or dalil to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe in Allah without any proof. We believe Allah is the creator without any proof. Subhanallah. I won't take much of your time. Just one last hadith for the benefit of the audience that we have here. Hazrat Talq bin Ali radiallahu ta'ala, he is the narrator of the second hadith, and he says that one individual came to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he posed a question and he said, الرجل يمس ذكره في الصلاة عليه الوضوء. Ya Rasulullah, one person is in his salat and he touches his private part directly. Does the wudu break? So the question is, if one touches his own private part, whether he is in salat or not in salat, what is the condition of wudu? Does wudu break or not? Now let us not forget that in the time of the Sahaba, their favorite surah was not just Inna Aatayna Im Kul Huwallah. So when they stood up in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they prepared themselves for tahajjud, that meant from Isha till Fajr they would be in Qiyam. They would be in Qiyam and they would read 5, 10 siparas, 15 siparas. Hazrat Osman would read in one raka'at, one Quran. One raka'at, one Quran. Allahu Akbar. The mother of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi would read 6 siparas after each salat. 6 paras after each salah. Subhanallah. These were great people in this ummah. And we still have great people like them. So, and it was hot, and the clothes were not like the clothes we wear today. It was lungi, and a loose-fitting lungi, like we wear, like when one would wear an ihram when he goes for Hajj or Umrah. So there is a possibility, unintentionally the hand went down, and the hand would touch the private part, unintentionally. There is a possibility, a masla could be there. Again, a beautiful explanation gave by Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَا. Your wuzu does not break. Although according to Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi and Imam Ahmad rahmatullah alayhi, that if you touch your private part, your wuzu breaks. Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi and some of the scholars are even more harsh and strict. They say even if you were to touch a woman who is the ghair mahram woman, and by touching that woman, your wuzu breaks. Your wuzu breaks. So that's why you will notice when some of the other people who follow the other fiqh, when they are being tawaf, they are extra careful. They are extra careful. So, and an explanation is given by Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِنَّمَا هُوَ بَضْعَةٌ مِنْكَ. Why should your wuzu break? That private part of yours is only something that is attached to your body. Like the eyes, the nose, the mouth, the ears are attachments of the head and the face. So even that, the private part of an individual is something that is an organ, a body part of that individual. So your wuzu does not break. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to make amal on what has been said. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakallah khair. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidil mursaleen. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا الله عليك نوف ما أخر ما يا الله جتنے لوگ یہاں بیٹھے ہوئے ہیں يا الله ذي الحجة کا مہینہ ہے يا الله اس مہینے میں يا الله تو بہت زیادہ مومنوں سے خوش ہے يا الله تو ہم سے خوش ہو جا يا الله تو ہم سے خوش ہو جا يا الله ہم یہاں بیٹھے ہوئے ہیں نبی کریم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کے الفاظ مبارکہ کو سننے کے لیے. یا اللہ نبی کریم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کے صدقے میں تو فعل میں یا اللہ تو ہماری مغفرت فرما. گھروں میں ماں بہنیں جو سن رہی ہیں یا اللہ ان کی بھی مغفرت فرما. مسلمانوں کی حفاظت فرما. وصلی اللہ تعالی علی خیر خلقی محمد وعلى آلہ واصحابہ وازواجہ وذریاتہ وآل بیتہ اجمعین برحمتک یا ارحم الراحمین.